Good morning, everybody. My name is Richard. I'm here with my colleague today, Arturas, from First Light Fusion. So today we will be talking about who we are, challenges we're trying to address, and the simulations infrastructure now in place, both from the hardware side and software side. Operational principles, so how we're working best for our scientists in our environment, and also some conclusions that we've come up with from our experience running this system. So who we are, First Light Fusion, we're a high energy density physics research organisation. We're privately funded by venture capitalists. We're spun out of Oxford University back in 2011. We are looking into research focusing on internally confined fusion. And our facilities in Oxford have both experimental side and a simulation side. So two different focuses that they both combine into the end result. So our main goal is to build up our intellectual property with regards to ICF and for the end goal of fusion as a power source. So starting off with our experimental facilities, we have here our two-stage catalyst. So at one end of this, you put in some gunpowder charge, then that accelerates a piston up to a burst disk. So at this point, we have a small projectile, a couple of grams in weight, gets accelerated down into that target chamber at the end. At this interface, we're really interested in actually modeling to try and understand what's happening. So here you can see the projectile coming in and hitting a target. That's overlaid with one of our simulations. There's these fluid dynamics here that we are really, really interested in simulating, understanding how they're working, looking at different permutations of that. That projectile hitting that target around about, in this case, 5.6 kilometers a second, and the gas gun we have has a capacity of up to about 8 kilometers a second to actually hit that small target. Put another overlay for you here, just in a slightly different design. And then you see our own in-house software, which we high-track overlaid on top in the green there. So, what challenges have we got? So, if we're producing journal data, we need to be making sure that this is reproducible, just to back up our own credibility, give ourselves traceability, so we can rerun these simulations and get the same results each time. So, the ideas, you know, all our scientists and developers coming up with different ideas, want to use different libraries, different packages, different softwares. So from my point of view, an IT systems engineer, that gives me a headache. How do I manage that? How do I encapsulate that all in one bit of a document that will run absolutely everywhere? So these simulations, they need to run smoothly on PCs. So you can do a small test run before you send it off to the cluster. And with all this, with the changing developments, every time you make a change, you want to make sure you're not breaking the rest of the physics. That's no good if your results coming out are broken by a previous bug you just put in. So we need to make sure we're producing and thoroughly testing these docking images. And from the end user's point of view, we need to make it as simple as possible for them to actually run their simulations. And we don't think automation makes everything much easier. So, what hardware do we have? We have our own in-house HPC system, 1008 cores across 36 nodes, using the Intel Kandy Pass node infrastructure. Running standard Xeon 5 chips, 128 gigs on each node, and high speed on the path interconnect, which gives us the ability to move on to power solutions. Also, we have our ordering workstations that scientists can do their small scale ones or performing on. Now, I'd like to click this next slide in. Put yourself back in 2002. How much would this have taken up space wise? This is your answer. So, for 35 teraflops of theoretical computing power, this used to take up 640 nodes. Nowadays, it takes up just 36 nodes to get the same equivalent power. So, I think that's a really nice image of Moore's Law in action there. So now I'm going to hand yourself over to my colleague Arturas, who can tell you a bit more about the software we're using and how we're actually implementing this.
So this is how it looks like. In essence, the user tells HPC, my file with input that represents Python script, which unlocks the job. And in essence, it also allows to, in addition to query running job, it allows to delete jobs if something went wrong. And it's prevent from one user to delete another user's submitted jobs. So as conclusions, we implemented a system which consists of continuous integration system that produces Docker images that are stored in registry and can be used in PC as well in HPC. And all computational results in that manner are fully reproducible. This means that if in future someone will want to run some simulation, older simulation, it can easily check which one Docker image was used. It can pull it that image and run computation and create new results if required. Also, Docker images hide all the software installation and packaging, versioning issue, and simulations can run on PCs as well on HPC. And also, we have a software quality that is controlled by continuous integration system. This means when user pushes its changes to repository, we run tests where our continuous integration system builds, for building purposes, uses Docker image itself, and if, all unit tests, regression tests, patch tests, results also are exposed to the developer. So we know either it's only one or two tests failing from a few thousand, or it's everything screwed and half of them fails. So it tells quality of image. And also all complexity of Docker, Kubernetes, registry input, output data sharing is hidden by HPC script. And software development is workflow is automated so that the developer needs to only one action just to push his changes to a repository, which is will trigger a continuous integration system, and produce a Docker image will be available to everyone that interested in it. Some experience gained during that development. Kubernetes pods do not have concept to run job once. They actually, all the system is designed to be sort of unbeatable, and this means if it job inside of Docker container fails or exit not gracefully, container itself keeps restarting. So we managed that contact problem just by better handling of the current status of executables. So this means that it improved our software quality and forced us to handle all errors occurring in C++ or Python code by try-catch except logs. Also, some pod information we needed to implement additional bash script that cleans some information. For example, when a Kubernetes job exit, it retains information in system about pods. So we implemented that. Also, we observed that it is quite complicated to user rights management using Docker images, because Docker runs as roots. So all data produced inside of Docker has root rights, while ordinary users do not have root rights, so it needed certain additional effort to overcome that problem. And also, one issue to someone can be job submission speed. Currently, job is submitted in seconds level. I hear somewhere that some job schedulers allow to submit even a few hundreds jobs per second, but for us it's completely okay because our jobs run days or weeks even, so 1 second is acceptable. And of course, all our reproducibility assumptions heavily depends on Docker implementers backward compatibility implementation, because we assume that if we will archive our Docker images, we will be able to run them after 1, 2, or 5 years later. But the API ensuring that needs to be backward compatible. And what we plan to do next, currently our HPC system allows us to run parametrical scan. This means we can run employ only separate nodes, but we want to solve a big problem where our HPC will act as single machine. So for that purpose, we plan to use high performance parallel X platform with active global address management space. And it also it is interesting to try multi-physics software chaining through Kubernetes pods and Docker. This means that Kubernetes pods allows to run a few Docker inside its own pod, and it's convenient to let's say use third-party software that implements finite element method like Phoenix in Docker image, then use another image that implements something else and chain them together in single pod. So, thank you for your attention.